So if I were a brand new employee at Gore, mm-hmm. I come right in, let's say I've had experience in Fortune 500 companies, and I come in, what's so different about Gore? What would I start picking up as being just very unique, distinct, different than?
It truly is a peer-based organization. We work collectively together. It's not the leader and everyone else. So everyone understands their job is to make everyone else successful. It's not just about their own personal success. So that really fundamental investment of time to build the relationships, get to know what each of us are capable of providing, is a critical shift in your thinking in terms of you come in, you work, and then you go home. So people are much more vested in terms of owning both their own outcome and feeling responsible, but also feeling part of the whole in terms of I can really make a difference here, and I truly care about the success of the organization.
What about, I've heard a term used, on-demand hierarchy. What do you mean by that?
So I think the misnomer is we don't have people in responsible roles, and right. Certainly we have structure. Sometimes I get accused that we have too much structure, which is always healthy. I think the difference is if there's a formal hierarchy that's fixed, it always assumes that the person at the top of the hierarchy is the most knowledgeable mm-hmm. and that they're really going to direct the rest of the organization. But if you think about how decisions are made, it shifts based on who really has the knowledge, who really has the vantage point that truly is the best person to drive a decision. Mm-hmm. So what we'd like to create is an environment where that shift of who's taking the lead, who's mm-hmm. driving the decision, is not a fixed structure, but it very much is situational. And so that kind of hierarchy on demand, that concept comes from, we really want it to occur naturally based on where the knowledge is, which really allows a lot more of your population to contribute to decision making. And that's, I think that's the beauty of it. Whereas a fixed hierarchy, unfortunately, all the decisions kind of go up the ladder, they come down the ladder, and it really doesn't necessarily get the best of the organization.
Yeah. Also, talk to us about ladder versus lattice organization. Mm-hmm. And you guys would be a lattice organization.
Exactly. The lattice concept was that really we're all connected by a series of nodes, which the analogy is actually around some of the structures of our materials that are very important to us. But the idea is we all want to connect with each other. So rather than there may be only two contact points that I have with my leader or superior, mm-hmm. what you really want to encourage is that everyone is connecting with everyone in their network, and we want people to go right to the source, directly to who they need to get to get information or to get things moving.
Now, the other thing that I saw that actually, it was kind of shocking when I read this quote, but I have a quote that you said, we don't tell people what to do, right. And we don't tell them what projects to work
right,
on.
Right.
Like, is that really
Sometimes
true?
Sometimes associates tell me what to do, which is 9,000 of them. Absolutely, and I think the other key difference that we talked about as far as what's different in Gore, leadership plays a very different role. Hmm. The leader is not the person that just arrived and now they're responsible, and so they kind of tell the organization what to do, which is very traditional. In traditional companies, there's a lot of pressure on that leader to have both the answers, but also to kind of direct their reports. The way we look at it is leaders have to do it through influence. And so, I don't tell associates what to do. I might try to influence them that this is really important for us to focus on. And the difference is you want that individual to feel the ownership. You want them to understand why it's important. And the energy and commitment shifts dramatically. So rather than the leader is the one that has the passion and they're the one that has the conviction, what you really want is that energy to shift to the broader organization. And so if I told someone what to do, they probably would do it, but the ownership and the commitment, they're doing it for me, mm-hmm. and it's something I believe in. It's so much more powerful when it's actually felt by the whole organization and they're equally committed to that outcome.
But if you're letting them run with their passion and what they want to do, how does this not turn into just herding cats? How do you get alignment?
It's never going to be all in a nice, neat, structured package. What we try to do, though, is to really make sure everyone's operating with kind of a common foundation of values and beliefs. And so when you join Gore, the assumption is you buy into the things that we think are fundamentally important. That belief in individual, that commitment to help each other be successful, kind of the approach we take and our philosophy to taking a long-term view. So you have to establish a common foundation and values. I think the leadership.
What are those? What are those common values
so
that employees?
For us, certainly, again, one is the belief in individual that we really respect and believe everyone can make a significant contribution. If you give associates the knowledge and the tools, they will just flourish. And so that's certainly one. The second is the power of small teams, that as we get larger, we want to still keep and continue to have associates that really feel part and connected with their team to make a difference. Mm-hmm. The other one is that we're all in the same boat. The Gores loved analogies with ships. And so the concept here is that it's, you know, even though small teams can do a lot, but we do much more as a ship. The entire enterprise benefits when we're all successful. So we really try to align all of our practices that truly reinforce that our success ultimately is you know, with us collectively together. And the last one is that we really want to take a long-term view. A lot of businesses, as you can imagine, are under a ton of pressure to deliver short-term results. And so we've always felt that our success is not financially driven alone. That's certainly one piece to keep the enterprise healthy, but how healthy is the work environment? Are we really reaching out in the communities, and are we building our reputation? You know, are we driving innovation? So those are the things that we try to reinforce in our practices. And that's really what we try to instill in our associates.
Okay, so let's get practical here. Mm-hmm. I'm an associate at Gore. I have a great idea for an application of the Gore technology. Mm-hmm. How do I get money? How does my idea get money?
Well, there's a lot of internal selling. And so just as I mentioned, leaders need to do a lot through influence. Every associate has that responsibility. Because, you know, job one is you've got to convince others that your idea is a good idea. And frankly, when you're in the innovation mode, not all ideas bubble up to be great ideas. And so there's kind of a selection process that happens naturally of how much passion does the individual have? Are they able to get other associates to believe in their idea? And so that fundamentally is kind of the first phase. And then as we actually invest in some of these areas, we actually like the peer review process to really make sure the best ideas bubble up. Because one of the constraints every organization has is investment in resources, whether it be people or finance. And so what's a process that you can actually vet those ideas that doesn't require the leader to come in and tell the team your project's funded, your project's not. So we try to flip that around and create what we would call success factors. Here are the things that are critically important in terms of things that we feel make our company successful. We then let the teams actually look at these different projects and then map out which ones are the most attractive and which ones are the least attractive. Associates want to work on the things that they can make the greatest impact.
Right.
Because the way they get rewarded is through peer evaluation. The way that works is you may have a team working together and they're asked to rank each of the associates that they know well, who is making the greatest contribution to the success of the enterprise. We don't give them a lot of criteria, so they have to really think about impact on their project, impact in terms of their building teams, helping to mentor. So it's a very comprehensive view of contribution. And associates know that. So, and we're a pretty competitive organization, and so you can imagine no one wants to get ranked last. So there's a built-in mechanism that everyone wants to be viewed by their peers as making the greatest contribution. Wow. And so what that allows.
So it's a forced rank. I mean, you're forced number one, number
exactly.
two, number three.
Exactly. Once you've figured out what that, you know, what that ranking looks like, we then plot compensation. And those that are making the greatest contribution are paid accordingly. And so what it removes from the system is that it's not by default the leader gets paid the most or the person that has the most seniority or the person that's the most vocal. We really want it to come, you know, from you know, our values and from the organization. And I think that has really helped serve as a great, I'd say, counterbalance to make sure that ultimately people understand that our success is very much going to be developed and measured by you know, the organization, not just a key few.
Well, not defining it so clearly and specifically, it's your contribution toward the success of the organization in any number of ways
exactly.
that can be assessed.
And one thing I'm sure in every organization you find is people sometimes will confuse what I need to do to be successful and make more money versus what really is my passion. Helps, yeah. And so this helps people really drive what they're passionate about, where they can make a contribution, which, you know, ideally they're making a bigger impact when you've got that alignment versus they're feeling they have to only one path to be successful, which may not be true to who they are or true to their strengths. Yeah.